We're going to have our guest come out now, Tony Hernandez, and we'll have a discussion with him. But what I want you to know that there was one debate that took place in the legislature or at the state fair with Tony Hernandez and Betty McCollum and I believe Steve Carlson for the Independent Party. And if you want to see that debate, you can go to MinnesotaConservative.com or MNCD4Conservative.com. We'll bring the graphic up here in a little bit, but you'll want to watch that whole debate. I bring that up because there are so few debates. And these candidates, when they do have public appearances, it's very limited in what they say. So you get to see at least the debate, but on this show, you get to have a lot of time with candidate Hernandez. And Nathan, put up the graphic on where they can watch the debate on MNCD4 Conservative. Thanks. Tony Hernandez, thanks for coming on the show.
Tim, thanks for having me.
Yeah, well, you're a busy guy. You were out partying in the streets, I heard, just a little while ago.
Well, yeah, we do a thing called a flash rally, and we've been doing it once a week, and we started early this summer, and we do it every single week. But we just go to a location where a lot of traffic comes by. Usually it's during a rush hour, either in the morning or in the afternoon. And today we had 15 people on the Bruce Vento Trail that goes right over Highway 36, Highway 36 in English.
Right, yeah.
And we had our red American Dream Hernandez for U.S. Congress t-shirts. And we had a big American flag that we get pinned up on the fence. And we have our big sign, Hernandez for U.S. Congress sign in our domain. And we just sit there and we wave at the traffic as they come by and just give big smiles. And it's just to let people know that, you know, we're in a race here and, you know, we're serious about representing the people and the families in the 4th Congressional District. And, you know, it's been a very Democratic stronghold since 1946.
Yes,
that's the last time a non-Democrat has won this seat and represented the people of the 4th. And that's what we're working so hard to change for. And really, as I go door to door, talking to the people of this district, a number one message that I let people know is that I care about the people and the families in this district. You know, that we really care about our future, but we also care about our present. You know, making sure we take care of our seniors, making sure that we honor our veterans, and also, most importantly, that we're setting the groundwork for our next generation so that they're going to have as many career opportunities, as many jobs, as much opportunity to make money, and then also as much individual freedom as you and I had and this viewing audience had growing up here in Minnesota.
Right.
It's a legacy that we're proud of here in America, is that we have been able to pass on to each generation a bigger and better quality of life. And really, for the first time in American history, this is at
it's a threat. It's going away. It's the progression is severely limited now, and our freedoms being taken away are a serious issue, and we got to get people into office that will defend our constitutional rights and our liberties, and that's not happening right now.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, candidates have two problems, especially coming into the area.
Mm-hmm.
One is name recognition.
Mm-hmm.
And so what you're doing, getting the signs out there, freeways or crossroads are great places to do that. Name recognition, so you're getting that done. People have to know you exist.
Mm-hmm.
And then another problem in our area is the press just kind of ignores our candidate.
Mm-hmm.
They just kind of, we won't cover them very much, you know. And as long as people, we don't put their name in the press, they're not going to know about them.
Mm-hmm.
So then our candidate, who would be their candidate, mm-hmm. favorite candidate, just has all the recognition.
Well, you know, to a certain degree, that's true. I will say, though, we have been working really hard to get the earned media, you know, to get the newspaper coverage, to get on programs like this, and also to get on the radio. And last Sunday, which was September 9th, We were on the very front page of the St. Paul Pioneer Press Dispatch. Our race was
okay.
The front page of the Sunday paper.
All right.
You know, it wasn't
wow.
even the local section.
Wow.
It was smack dab right there. And yeah, I woke up on Sunday morning next to my wife Leona, and my Twitter feed on my phone was going.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I was like, "What's going on?" And it's like, "Congratulations, you made the front page." And automatically, I assumed, "Oh, front page of the local, you know,
sure.
that of the local section. You know, that's
yeah,
not bad."
Right.
And then, sure enough, when I got the St. Paul Pioneer Press, there we were, and they
yeah.
featured our race. And Dennis right. Lean, who's a journalist at the St., he wrote a fairly good article, and he painted, you know, myself and, you know, also represent McCollum in favorable lights, but he really got down to some of the issues too.
Huh.
So I think that you're seeing a change in some of these, you know, the way that people are being covered and the way that the parties are being covered, because we are at such a crossroads in our nation's history.
Right.
And even the mainstream media is starting to see, you know, that some of these big government career politicians have not necessarily been serving the people and the families of this district and across this country well, because the economy is so bad.
Right.
There's so many people that are still suffering from unemployment, underemployment. They're making less money than they did 5 years ago. They're sitting in a real estate situation where they owe more than what their property is worth, or even
right.
other people that I've talked to. They can't make their property tax and mortgage payments at the same time.
Right.
So they have the bank calling them,
mm-hmm.
threatening foreclosures. So you're seeing a lot of people hurting in our district. And the leadership that the Washington elite or the Washington Democrats and Republicans have been offering us have been failing the families here on the economy and on jobs,
mm-hmm.
and everything else that I just described. So you're seeing people's eyes being opened, and people are more willing to look past, you know, your party affiliation,
you're
really
right.
looking at the person and the ideas, because more and more people are becoming...
And looking at the problem, yeah, the person, the problem, and saying, I got to get more information and deal more.
Yep.
I got to be more educated myself, because all of a sudden I got hurt by other people's decisions too.
Yeah.
Not just your own, but, you know, when circumstances beyond your control come in, well, what happened? How did it happen? How do I prevent that from happening again?
Mm-hmm.
Now, another big area is, you know, it's not just St. Paul and Ramsey County. Now it's a lot of Washington County.
Yeah, yeah, you're right.
A whole new area.
It brings a whole new dynamic. You know, every 10 years, and you're aware of this, but every 10 years there's redistricting of our congressional districts. And because Congressional District 4 got smaller in population, and the 6th district, which was Congresswoman Bachman's district, grew in population. The 4th took in some of the old 6. So
mm-hmm.
The new areas of our district are Stillwater, Afton, Lake Elmo, Bayport, that whole area
right.
Around there. So it brings in a different dynamic, because the St. Paul DFLer may be different than the Afton or Lake Elmo DFLer. People
sure.
tend to be more fiscally aware of the financial issues on the eastern parts of our district.
Well, and I think that's a big, I think that's one issue the Pioneer Press may have put you on the front page there. But also, I think you're going to, it is a different breed. And so Betty has to go out and debate,
mm-hmm.
but is she? Do you have some other debates or forums coming up? Because
mm-hmm.
typically she doesn't like to do that, because she's had a safe seat. Why go out and debate and put yourself at risk?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, with the new district and the new areas of our district, you know, nobody in Washington County, and half of Washington County is now in the 4th congressional district. They're not aware, most of them, who Representative McCollum is. They've never voted for Betty McCollum before.
And they don't know you that well.
And they don't know me either, which puts us on an equal footing, though, which is good
yes.
for me.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because, you know, it's an opportunity to get out there and to introduce myself and to let people know that I'm very serious about representing the people, and also intelligent on the issues and in terms of bringing forth solutions. And so she does have to work hard. And going to your question about the debates, We did have our first debate at the Minnesota State Fair. Yeah. So NPR had their debate. It was a fantastic time, and we really got into some of the issues.
Very good debate, yeah.
Which you said you can see that on YouTube, too.
Right, and Nathan, you want to bring that graphic up of where they can watch that debate again, MNCD4 conservative.
Yep, so we had that one. We have a League of Women Voters debate. I think that's on October 15th or somewhere around there.
Okay.
We've all agreed to a KSTP debate, so we'll be on live television, Channel 5.
All right, I got to ask some questions on that. From what I'm hearing in the past, she agrees to a KSTP thing, but then backs down. I don't, you know, this is my message to Representative McCollum. It's important that these debates take place and the people hear you and Tony and the other candidates. And so don't back out of the KSTP debate. You need to be there. So the people. And I don't know why you've backed out before, but there's no reason to do it in any of these debates. And you got another debate coming up?
So League of Women Voters, KSTP. There's a Stillwater Gazette forum that's being hosted, and we're trying to get one more lined up. And I must say, as a compliment to Representative McCollum, she has been forthright in accepting these debates, and I think it's because she does have to work a little harder to get her name out into the new areas of the district. You know, she did agree to the NPR debate, and you know, everything that I've met of Representative McCollum, she's a nice person. We get along well. I have no personal qualms with her. But when we debate, it's strictly on the issues because they're big issues these days,
and
it's
huge
not
issues.
Necessarily black and white in a lot of these things about, you know, job creation and solving the financial crisis and getting our economy back on track. So it's really, really important, like you said, to hone out these issues because, you know, one issue that came up in our debate was Medicare.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what are we going to do for our seniors moving forward in order to keep Medicare solvent for those that need it? And, you know, she challenged me. She's like, well, Tony, so, you know, what solutions do you have for Medicare? And, well, I said, well, I think one area that, you know, we could look at to reform Medicare is means testing.
Sure.
And this is this idea that, for instance, if you have a senior who's in retirement, who has multi-million dollars of assets and multiple streams of income, that person perhaps does not need as much as a senior who is poor, who doesn't have the savings, didn't save for retirement for whatever reasons, but that person needs more benefits perhaps than the rich senior.
So right now that very wealthy millionaire income senior can get a supplement because of Medicare.
Mm-hmm.
And so that supplement is at a reduced cost because Medicare is there, where they can afford a supplement that would have higher. So freeing up the insurance companies to say, have a policy out there that say, hey, you can forget Medicare. You don't have to have it, you know, as a backup in case you lose all your money.
Yep.
But here's a policy. So there's not this free market going on even in the Medicare situation.
No, not at all. And I've had seniors or retirees approach me and say, hey, Tony, you know, I don't need my Social Security check, but I can't get out of it. Or I don't need my Medicare. I'm already covered.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, but I still have to receive the benefits.
Right.
So I think common sense says, well, let's give our well-off or well-to-do seniors an opt-out option. You know, we're out of their own goodwill if they, determine that they don't need it, that they can opt out.
But then if something happens, they cannot back in.
Yep. And also, I think it's important to point out that we don't want to take away Medicare from anybody. Or Social Security, because people have paid and invested into this their entire life. And to just say that you don't get any of your benefits, that's not what we want to do here. That's not fair. It's not right or anything. But what we're talking about is making sure that our most vulnerable and impoverished seniors are taken care of. Meanwhile, the ones that are better off and have more savings get some, but they don't need as much as the senior who doesn't have as much.
Well, it's just having creative minds, but they have to be created towards a free market system.
Mm-hmm.
And that I just don't think is there with our current representative. And hopefully you're helping her be more creative with the competition and saying, boy, I got to do more work because mm-hmm. I just don't think it's been happening. Mm-hmm. And I have two issues mm-hmm. here that I want to talk about. Of course, this is what I do my show on a lot is family law, judiciary. And of course, as a federal representative, you get to impeach judges, and it does happen at mm-hmm. the federal level quite often, more than people know. But I'm not going to deal with that issue. That's something that will come along. You're going to know all about that. But family law is a serious thing. And parental rights, you know, we're a country founded on parental rights, the right to raise your children in the religion and upbringing of your choice, education of your choice. And that has eroded in the United Nations with the Convention on the Right of the Child, even though you won't be able to ratify a UN treaty or anything like that. But there's this big effort to take away parental rights. And courts play games. For example, a court said I couldn't teach my kids any inappropriate religious ideas or force them into Bible lessons for safety reasons. No findings of fact, no conclusions of law, just thrown into an order. Well, a judge can do that because there is nothing in our Constitution that says parents have rights to raise their kids in the upbringing and education of their choice. It's silent, yet we have history that it's that way. Mm-hmm. So there is a constitutional amendment out called the parentalrights.org constitutional amendment mm-hmm. that would put in our Constitution that parental rights have this fundamental right. Mm-hmm. And that fundamental right means the state would have to prove harm to the child. Mm-hmm. The child would have to be in danger in order for those parents to lose their rights. And right now, the parent has to prove that they're not endangering their child. Mm-hmm. And it goes beyond physical abuse, which any parent, when there's physical abuse happening, should be highly questioned and looked at. Mm-hmm. And depending on the degree and depending on the cooperation of the parent. But they're going and say, hey, you're teaching them something we don't like you teaching. Mm-hmm. And taking the kids away and forcing that parent to prove they're a good parent mm-hmm. without any evidence that they're not. So that's the constitutional amendment. So I just kind of want to find out where you're at on that issue.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, as you know, I'm a strong proponent of this idea of liberty
uh-huh.
and familial independence. And as somebody who was raised in the private school education, it was a choice that my parents made. It wasn't my choice at the time, but you know, it's something that I valued and something that they instilled into me. Mm-hmm. And it's something that I find very important. And I think that, you know, when we, you know, this is probably something that the founders of this country didn't think about.
Because it
wasn't
standard.
An issue
yeah.
back then.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, there was different types of education, and most kids were, I got to look at the history, but I'm sure most were homeschooled.
Absolutely, yeah.
Or in a schoolhouse with other farm children.
Yeah,
or
they freely associated, and there was no school boards, mm-hmm. and, you know, and it was the parents' control, yeah.
So, you know, looking forward now, and if you look at some of the activity that our government on various levels is taking part in, I'm alarmed at how willing politicians are and legislators are to try to dictate or make choices for you and I as adults, you know, whether
right.
it's how much soda you should be drinking or whether or not you should have that beer or go to McDonald's or,
right.
You know, even on a bigger level, who your doctor should be or what types of treatments you need for certain illnesses.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm alarmed, you know, by that because it's been my experience, and I'm only 33 years old, but it's been my experience that most of the things that our federal government or even a lot of governments try to get in to solve, they tend to usually just make the problem bigger
right.
and worse and more prevalent. And so, you know, I read it into the initiative, and from what I see thus far, this is something that I want to be on board with in terms of securing parental rights and just making sure that families have autonomy and
right.
parents have the autonomy to make the choices
yeah.
that they think is best
yeah.
for their children. And in that aspect, it makes a lot of sense. And it reminds me of a video that I saw. It's on YouTube. If you YouTube it, it's the title is Our Democrats really that pro-choice is what it
is.
And it was a gentleman who shouted at the Democratic National Convention, and the first question he was asking about was, you know, do you believe in a woman's right to choose, a woman's right to choice?
Sure.
And they were like, yeah, of course, you know, a woman should be able to make her own choices on her own health care, her own body. And so that was the very first part of the video. And then the rest is about various other choices. Well, okay, so you believe in choice, you know, that was established. It's like, well, do you think, you know, do you agree what Mayor Bloomberg was doing in New York City?
That she can't have a 32-ounce pop.
Oh, no, and they were like, no, you know, government needs to step in and prevent people from making harmful choices to themselves. And it's pretty interesting, though, because it shows some of the double standards that there are and this idea of choice, you know, but really at the end of the day.
Yeah, well, you can't abuse yourself. You can't cut yourself.
No.
You can't. I mean, they'll put you in a psych ward. They take people off the street and put you in psych wards.
Yep.
Longer than the 48 hours and no charges or whatever. And you can be sane and they'll put you in a psych ward. Mm-hmm. I've seen that happen. But, that's a good comment. Well, 42 hours if they're going to charge you with something, but 72 hours for a psych ward, which there is no law that constitution that allows you to do that. That's not a federal issue. That's a state issue as far as I understand. I've talked to Betty about this. I mean, and I've sent her a letter, and she will not make a commitment on that constitutional amendment. She has not signed on. She says, well, it will come through the committees at some times. Well, it's been through the House Judiciary Committee. They had a hearing. Mm-hmm. And what on all these constitutional amendments, you sign on as an author or you don't. And if you do, that means you're a favor, and if you don't, that does mean you're not for it. And she has not made the common sense decision to support that constitutional amendment. And it's House Joint Resolution 110 for Representative McCollum there. You can sign on right away, but I doubt she will. Well, I'm glad to hear your position on it. I think that's important because a family, if an intact family is going and structured, our government is not involved. The government's not spending money on that family.
Yeah.
And they actually get money from that family. Mm-hmm. That's the amazing thing. Mm-hmm. So I think they would be wanting intact families and parents having the freedom to make the decisions for the kids. And it doesn't cost the government money. Now the other issue I have here was, I was at a debate, we're going to play a clip here, Nathan, if you're ready on that. At a town hall meeting, it was at a union hall, and what was going on is somebody asked a question about the Stillwater Bridge, and asked it, and I don't know how well it will come out in the sound, but the question was, what are you going to do to help promote the Stillwater Bridge? So let's run that video and see what happens.
Not all your friends and neighbors probably know what you are.
I'm actually from the 6th District, and my question is, with the bridge, as I understand it, to go over Stillwater, that bridge has got enough money allocated to actually build the bridge, what can we do to get that bridge built? How can you help us?
Stillwater deserves to have the bridge replaced. The bridge proposal that Congresswoman Bachman and Senator Klobuchar have proposed is not a plan that I think will see the bridge be built. I think it's going to land up in court. It's very, very expensive. It'd be the most expensive, compared to 35. Hugely expensive bridge. There's a lot of opposition in Congress for building those kinds of projects. So I think the environmental question on it that we could land up in court again. I think that there's a way to build a bridge and work with the environmental community. There's been alternative bridge designs that have been put out there. Stillwater deserves to have that bridge replaced. But what I don't want to see is for the plan as it is to be moving forward, because I don't think it will pass, and I don't think it will stay out of court. And the other concern that I have is I don't think there's enough money in that plan to do all the infrastructure work that goes along Highway 36. How many have driven on Highway 36? It's fully at capacity. When I asked MnDOT, if you put a mega bridge at the end, you know, how does that work? You know, if 36 is capacity, where's the money for doing 36? And I have yet to get an answer for that. So the money that is there can be used for other projects. And let me give you an example. In Ramsey County alone, there is 10 bridges that MnDOT's rated. In Ramsey County, there are 7 out of the 10 bridges that are listed as structurally deficient, Cayuga being one of them. And that money can get plowed right back here in Ramsey County, putting people back to work to do bridges if we can't come up with an alternative bridge that I think will pass muster of cost and not land up in court again. Because the bridge proposal that's being proposed is, for all intents and purposes, identical to the bridge proposals that have landed up in court and failed before.
I heard that and I go, okay, Cayuga Bridge, huh? I never heard of it before, but I've driven it over thousands of times, found out where it was. And Nathan, can we put up the scan converter? Now, I want you, I just Googled it. Okay, is this Cayuga Bridge really in bad shape that it needs to be replaced? And we're not funding it, you know, and we need to take the money away from Stillwater to fund this bridge. So it looks like the scan converter is not working.
I'm not getting it. Do you have the right cable going?
I do, but it's not working.
Okay,
people, you have to Google Cayuga Bridge, St. Paul, Minnesota. It's just south of the Maryland Bridge, Case Avenue, and then Cayuga Street, just before University Avenue. And guess what? It is scheduled to be replaced in 2013. The Maryland Bridge, which is another bridge she was talking about, was already going to be replaced this year and is being replaced.
Yep, right, so, by her office.
So I was just, she's uninformed about these things. And the other thing about the Stillwater Bridge, was that expensive? Well, it's 3 times the length of 35W. You know, so it's going to be more expensive, but then the infrastructure is also part of that expense.
Yeah, and I'm born and raised in St. Paul. I still live in St. Paul. So I've had to talk to a lot of people that live in Stillwater in this area over the last year to really get a firm handle on the situation. And if you talk to people that have lived in Stillwater for a long, long time, they'll tell you that the debate for a new bridge started well before I was even born.
Yeah.
I was born
absolutely.
In 1979.
Yeah.
And, there's been initiatives to try to get this bridge done for the people, the families and the businesses of Stillwater in that area. And every excuse has been used in the book as to why not get this done. But going back to the issue of cost, if this would have been done in 2003 and 2004, this project would have costed hundreds of millions of dollars less, just due to inflation and the different market that we're in right now and the cost of the materials and labor and the whole deal. So the longer and longer that this building of the bridge was delayed, the more and more that it was going to get cost the taxpayers.
The higher the cost would
be. And so to get it done immediately was just something that needed to be done. And, there was all these issues, all the environment and the air pollution that this bridge would cause. But if you talk to people in Stillwater, there's about 5 different ways to get out of Stillwater during rush hour, and the amount of congestion and car exhaust that is all around
that
Stillwater as,
up,
a,
yeah.
as a result of not having the bridge is probably, and I'm not a scientist, but it could be just as much damaging to the people's lungs who have to breathe it in and listen to the noise pollution and everything. So. And I think that's one consequence of that a lot of us have been failed on that live in the 4th Congressional District is because this has been such a traditionally safe Democratic seat, people, when they get in, they stay in for too long and they become detached from the issues because they don't have to get in and know everything back and forth. And this was evident a couple times in our debate. I know that Representative McCollum brought up the Ryan budget. And because we were talking about how the federal government hasn't passed a budget in over 4 years, and how especially the U.S. Senate is failing America, and how the Democrats, they had a majority, a supermajority in 2009 with the presidency, the U.S. Senate,
right,
and the Democratic majority in the House, and they still didn't get
right
a budget done then. And they could have made any budget that they wanted to, and it would have passed through, and they failed to do it. So Representative McCollum was talking about the Ryan budget and how, you know, the House did in fact pass a budget this year, which is right, but she said she didn't vote for the Ryan budget because it only, and this was what she said, and it's on video, but she said it only had tax cuts for the very rich. And it's just simply not true. The Ryan budget kept the tax rates the same for all Americans, for all taxpayers. It didn't raise or lower taxes for anyone. It just kept the rates the same
where they
for
were,
all Americans.
Where they where are they now. And then probably adjusted the spending a little bit.
Yeah, and you know, it's just, it's sad because ideologues right now are the ones that are ruling Congress, and they're the rigid ideologues on both sides, unfortunately, and it's not all of them, but they are causing the partisanship and the gridlock. You know, you have one side that says all we need to do is, and our problems will be solved, is to tax the rich, and anyone who does the math on taxing the rich realizes
can't happen.
It's a drop in the bucket.
You'll never get
in terms
money.
Of deficit reduction. And not only that, but it would probably drive out even more millionaires out of this country, which is not what we want to do.
It'll
at
stop
this point.
The competition and lead to mediocrity.
Yep, and so it's that type of ideology, you know, that unfortunately gets people elected, and it keeps them in their seat, but it doesn't get anything done for the working families, for the people looking for jobs, for the people backwards on their mortgages, for the young ones who are being piled on top of the national debt. So, you know, it's this extreme partisanship and this inability to really get into the details and work together and reach across the aisle and try to build some type of a consensus.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, and I've heard you talk about jobs, and I thought you had a unique perspective of it, because I kind of heard you say that the government does have a role to play with jobs, and a lot of people say, government, get out, you don't have a role, you can't create jobs, blah, blah, blah. And for a majority of it, that's true. Government can't create jobs. But, I mean, they do. Obviously, they can create government jobs. But you had an interesting spin. So, I mean, you're not on the part that government doesn't have a role in creating jobs. You say they do.
Yeah. Well, you know, if you look at what can the federal government do to have job creation, to grow the economy, there's a wide variety of things that the federal government does do. And it's setting tax rates. It's having the tax infrastructure. And it's also setting the regulatory procedures for the businesses. And right now, we've gone so far to this side in terms of what the federal government is doing in terms of intervening in the economy, where we actually have a federal government that's actively involved in killing jobs. And Representative McCollum, in many of her policies, are job-killing policies. And, you know, the taxes, and even more so that you hear from the small businessmen and women, it's the regulations that the federal government is sending down that are literally strangling business growth and job growth right here in Minnesota. And you can look at, you know, certain issues in the Affordable Care Act, for instance. You know, the Supreme Court, Justice Roberts, ruled that, you know, the Affordable Care Act was constitutional because Congress has the power to tax. And, you know, the more people see the Affordable Care Act for what it is, they realize it is just a set of various taxes and bureaucratic layers of government. But one tax in there in particular, the medical device tax, it's a 2.3% excise tax on the medical devices industry. And this tax is a direct job killer right here in Minnesota. St. Jude's announced 300 people would be laid off because of the medical excise tax.
Wow.
Stryker, which is another medical devices company, it's not here in Minnesota, but they announced because of this Affordable Care Act tax, they were going to lay off 5% of its workforce. Medtronic made some similar announcements and whatnot. So we see firsthand that this tax and some of the taxes in the Affordable Care Act are directly killing jobs here in Minnesota.
They not only did kill jobs, but you're killing jobs at the higher end of the scale, and therefore you won't get the tax revenue from these people that make the money.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so you get this cycle, this ball rolling that just cycles downward.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to come to a level where you let the creative and let, you got to be at a spot where jobs can grow.
Mm-hmm.
And $2.6 trillion is what the cost to implement Obamacare or the Affordable Health Care Act.
Is that over 10 years? Or? I think that's probably what that figure is.
Well, I think it was a higher number for over that. I think that's, once implemented. So over the next, once it's going, it's $2.6 billion a year.
Yeah.
So it's a high number. Where's the money come from?
Yeah. Yeah, and,
Printing machines.
That's
inflationary.
Yeah, and you have to look. This issue came up in the NPR debate, and one thing that I pointed out, because when I looked out in the crowd, I saw Republicans on this side, I saw the vote Betty Schultz on this side, people in the middle, but in the fourth district, we have to explain what we really mean. And one thing I'm really worried about with the Affordable Care Act is right now here in Minnesota, we have one of the best healthcare systems in the entire world.
Uh-huh.
In Minnesota, over 90% of our residents here are covered by some type of health insurance, whether it's, I think around 60% are covered by a private health insurance company.
Okay.
Another 20% or so is covered by MinCare. Don't quote me on these numbers, but another 10% is covered through Medicare and Medicaid and whatnot. So our citizenry here in Minnesota, over 90% of our people are taken care of.
Right,
and that's a testament to our vibrant economy. It's a testament to a certain degree to MinCare and to the caring spirit of our medical industry, doctors and nurses here. We really care about people. And so what I was challenging the audience on is, do you want to risk ruining what we have here in Minnesota to implement a one-size-fits-all, top-down, bureaucratic approach to healthcare and trust the people in Washington, D.C. to take care of your health, your grandmother's health, your great-aunt's health? And most people, if they think about what the history of the federal government and what the limited roles of this government have been and what they're getting into, I don't think most people want to take that type of a gamble.
No.
Because...
I see the role the government should play as you go out and get that private contract and you go out and you look at the terms of your contract and you make that agreement. And the government's role is to say, hey, you guys had this contract, you got to keep it now, okay? And make sure the insurance companies are keeping up on their end of the bargain.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, the individual has to keep paying.
Mm-hmm.
But when I sold health insurance, and the thing that amazed me, and, of course, I've bought it, and, amazed me is a lack of competition. Even though we have competition here in Minnesota, you're mm-hmm. limited to four companies.
Mm-hmm.
But also the lack of options. There mm-hmm. wasn't a policy out there that I liked the way it was designed.
Mm-hmm.
I had to buy coverage that I knew I wasn't going to use.
Mm-hmm.
And so mm-hmm. it just increased the cost for me.
Yeah.
And so this competition wasn't playing. And
get
rid of competition.
Yeah. I mean, in so many ways, healthcare is different than, a shoe, selling shoes or cars or anything. It is a little more intimate to our humanity mm-hmm. with that aspect. But at the same time, the market-driven reforms are the reforms that are going to increase the options that we have, and also it'll cater to the individual. And, the way I see health insurance being most successful moving forward is to really get rid of this idea of the employer based insurance model, which
yeah.
I'm not saying employers shouldn't provide insurance.
Competition.
It's their choice.
I mean,
if that's how they want to do their business.
It can be a competitive piece to the puzzle.
But I don't think that that's the optimal way to be covered, because when you have high unemployment and people get fired
right.
from their job, all of a sudden, guess what? You don't have insurance.
Right.
And then you're either driven to a government program or a very, very expensive program that you're going to try to buy on your own, because those aren't subsidized through the taxpayer. So, you know, really, I see, you know, the type of insurance, you know, that would be most beneficial are insurances where an individual can buy in early, like life insurance, you know, where you buy
right.
in
or
early.
Right, a health savings account type
or large health savings
accounts. Those are great.
Yeah, you know, where you put more the responsibility on the individual, you know, in terms of taking care of their bodies and making the choices that'll give them the, you know, the best health
the
and the lowest cost.
They see the benefit of being healthy because they save money on
mm-hmm.
a lot of things,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
Not only their health insurance, but auto insurance has a play in that and a lot of things.
Yeah, and you know, the number one thing that people will ask about, well, what about, you know, if you get the person who doesn't get insurance, you know, we all have to pay for that person.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, as somebody, I had a life-changing moment at one time. I was injured pretty severely. Somebody threw a 12-pound rock from a bridge, and I was in a car going 70 miles under the bridge, 70 miles an hour, and it crashed through the windshield and hit me on the right side of my abdomen, and it put
wow.
me into the hospital in the ICU, and the doctors, and thanks to all the great American innovation we have with trauma,
mm-hmm.
they saved my life, and,
right.
and I had insurance at the time. But, you know, I think it's important that we,
mm-hmm.
you know, bring some type of a solution for, you know, I do think we need a safety net. We don't, as Americans,
yeah,
it's not in our culture to let somebody die on the street,
mm-hmm.
to let somebody bleed to death, or if somebody is in a terrible accident. Like, we have a moral obligation to help that person recover, get to a point where they're back to their own. But the idea that the taxpayer should be, you know, on the dole for every little health procedure that really healthy individuals should be taking care of on,
mm-hmm.
on their own and paying their doctor directly or finding
yeah.
alternative routes to good, healthy living, I think will go a long, long way in terms of just bringing back that idea of personal responsibility and taking care of your own health and,
mm-hmm.
and making the decisions that are best for you and your pocketbook.
Yeah.
'Cause at the end of the day, you spend your money on yourself way better than any government bureaucracy could do.
Right.
I'm in that same boat as you, and I'm sure most people in the yeah. viewing audience here are that same way as well. They are able
okay.
to make their own choices the best. So.
All right. Well, we got 1 minute left here.
Sure.
Okay, so give us your 1 minute speech as to what you want to tell the people and
sure.
and how you want to hear from them.
Well, my name is Tony Hernandez, and running for the United States House of Representatives in the 4th Congressional District. I would be honored to represent you, the people, the families of this district. I'd be honored to honor our veterans and also make sure that our students have a great environment for when they graduate, that they're graduating with less debt, more job opportunities, more career opportunities, and most importantly, more freedom. Because moving forward, we have to think outside of the box. We got to get outside of this idea of a Democrat versus a Republican and start looking at the people that are running in terms of their vision and their solutions for our great challenges of the day. So our website is HernandezUSA.com. That's HernandezUSA.com. I'd invite you to join our campaign, either volunteering or donating. And I certainly do ask and would appreciate and be honored by your vote. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Tony Hernandez, for coming on.
Thank you.
And remember, people, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. And Tony, thanks for standing
Thank
up
you,
and
Tim.
Being a good man. So God bless.
God bless you.
All right.
And God bless America.
You bet.
I see that you're lost.